political activism and his documentaries, Sohail is also very well known for the immersive heritage walks that he conducts around the capital. Madhu Prasad is also a JNU alumna, has taught philosophy in Delhi University, and is a presidium member of the All India Forum for Right to Education. She was a member of the 1972-73 Students' Union at JNU, which was actively involved in framing the admission policy here. Sohail and Madhu will be speaking to us today about JNU's deprivation point system, its history and politics.
Thank you. What Madhu and I will do is, I am basically going to give you the chronology, how the deprivation points were evolved and how they were implemented and some of the initial changes that were introduced. And Madhu will basically talk about, that is the idea, but you know what I leave out, all that she's going to cover. And maybe a whole lot of other things, especially the extremely complicated negotiations that took place. Before I begin, I just want to place before you that the admission policy was not given by the administration. The admission policy was evolved, was thought of, conceived, and then evolved at the behest of the JNUSU and the students of this university. And this is something that needs to be remembered. This was not a gift from the administration. Within the administration, there were people who were sympathetic. Within the administration, there were a whole lot of people who were dead set against the admission policy. And the dilution that has taken place over the last few decades is a result of this attitude of the administration, which is now coming out in the shape in which all of you are witnessing it. Because I don't want to miss out anything, I'm going to read out. This is a short note. The first lot, and before JNU began, some of this begins before JNU was set up. The first lot of admissions to JNU happened in 1971. These were admissions to MPhil and PhD courses only. The Indian School of International Studies, that functioned under the aegis of the Indian Council of World Affairs, and the Center of Russian Studies, were taken over to become SIS and the School of Foreign Languages. Subsequently, the School of Foreign Languages was renamed School of Languages and is now known as School of Languages, Literature and Cultural Studies. In 1972, interview-based admissions to master's course were started, and it is the same year when School of Languages started admitting students to the undergraduate course, 5-year course, which culminated in a master's course. In 1973, an admission policy based on the idea that JNU is a national university and it should therefore have an admission policy that would ensure that the student intake reflects the national character of JNU, not only in the geographical spread of the intake, but the university should open its doors to those who had largely been excluded due to their socio-economic deprivation and due to a system that thrived on exclusion. The in-principle acceptance of this position by the university, despite strong reservations by some votaries of pure merit, was a reflection not only of the majority of the students, but also of the majority of the senior faculty of the university. The acceptance of the policy by the university administration was in marked contrast to how most university administrations behaved then and the present administration of JNU is behaving currently. There was a clear understanding that the role of administration was restricted to releasing of advertisements, inviting applications for admission and receiving forms, and later making arrangements for centers where exams would be conducted. All other decisions regarding determining checking admissibility academic suitability, etc., were under the total purview of the faculty. It is this broad consensus between the students, teachers and administration, arrived at after many months of negotiations and many sleepless nights of arguments and fine-tuning of text, that the admission policy of JNU was finally framed. From 1974, admissions based on written exam and an interview plus award of points aimed at compensating for age-old socio-economic deprivation and regional backwardness were put in place. We need to understand the complexity of the point system and the logic with which they were arrived at. There were 20 points for socio-economic and regional backwardness. Those belonging to scheduled caste and scheduled tribes were awarded 9 points. 6 points to be awarded to those belonging to other backward castes was subsequently introduced, and this practice was in force till reservation for OBCs was introduced. For economic backwardness, a maximum of 7 points were awarded to those whose family income was less than Rs. 700 per month. Now, this might sound like small change, but this is just an indication of how low were the general incomes at that time, and talking of the 1970s. And how phenomenally high is the price rise in these days, which has pushed up notional salaries. For incomes between 700 to 800 points, 6 points were awarded. For those students whose monthly family income was between 800 to 900 rupees per month, 5 points were awarded. For incomes up to 1,000 rupees per month, 4 points were awarded. Those whose family incomes were more than 1,000 rupees a month did not get any economic backwardness points.
The other way now, below 300
but 7. Yes. Economic backwardness points were discontinued from 1984. Women applicants belonging to backward castes and backward districts were given 5 points extra. This practice was introduced only in late 1990s. Later, this was extended to all female candidates. Points for regional deprivation were introduced based on the 1971 census of district-wise categorization of regional backwardness. This was calculated on the basis of the Ashok Mitra classification of districts as developed, less developed, backward, and very backward. This categorization was also mediated by work done by a Russian demographer, Galina Sadyasuk, who had also worked on levels of backwardness and development in India. And these two were combined together to develop the quartiles. Now, the top of the quartile was the most developed, and the bottom of the quartile was the least developed. So the weightage for regional backwardness was worked out on an inverted system. Those coming from the least backward district, the least developed districts, were given 4 points for regional backwardness. Those who came from backward districts were given 3 points. And those who came from the most developed and less developed did not get any regional backwardness points. The policy underwent many changes, was gradually diluted, and is now sought to be buried. But we need to remember that it was this admission policy and the award of point system that ensured that an SCST student belonging to the lowest income category and hailing from a district falling in the most backward quartile would get 20 points if the student had not been to a privileged school, as against a student who was not an SC or ST and belonged to a family with high income bracket and hailed from the first quartile district in levels of development index. In other words, somebody who had been to a public school, had lived in a city or a developed district, and whose monthly income was more than 1,000 rupees a month, will get 0 points. as opposed to somebody who came from a socio-economically backward background, belonged to an SCST family, and had studied in a backward district. This was an attempt to compensate the burden of backwardness that these students were brought with them and were discriminated against because of their backwardness. It was this that provided competitive parity to students belonging to socio-economically discriminated communities and to those who belong to the most backward areas of India. Whether the points for socio-economic and regional backwardness were being awarded according to the principles laid down in the admission policy was scrutinized in a center-level student-faculty committees. The committees consisted of 5 elected representatives of students and 5 members of the faculty of the center. In case of a dispute, the matter would be referred to the school-level SFC. The students had also taken a clear position that issues of academic assessment were the prerogative of the faculty, while ensuring that points of backwardness had been awarded properly was something that was open to scrutiny. It needs to be remembered that it was this admission policy evolved at the initiative of the JNUSU and accepted after many rather bitter debates that was the basis upon which the portals of JNU were open to a large number of students from the length and breadth of the country who would never have had the opportunity of entering any university had this policy not been in place. One also needs to remember that it is this inclusive atmosphere that ensured that JNU did not have eve-teasing and ragging and was free of regional, casteist and communal politics for a large part of its existence. Thank you.
First of all, I want to greet the students of Jawaharlal Nehru University who have been for at least 2 years been carrying on a consistent struggle against the forces which are trying to turn back the student movements, its achievements and the struggles that you are raising in the interests of all the students of this country. I know that you have been very active through the struggle which started off with the 9th February arrests and the disruption on the campus. You were very active through the Occupy UGC struggle and now on this admission policy, it seems almost like we are going back 40 years. Because I was in the Students' Union in 1972-73. That is a period which is literally 40 years, more than 40 years ago. And Jawaharlal Nehru University, JNU, had just started at that time. And it had been started with the idea. It had been started with the idea that it would correct some of the problems which continue to persist in older universities in India, universities which still carried their colonial character. Because JNU was the one university which was started with the idea of a modern, liberal, democratic environment and one in which it would really be representative of the student body and the youth of the country. Whereas the colonial ideas which had continued were always that of elite universities. I think there is a tragedy in our country that because we have failed to universalize school education, any student, even if coming from the most disadvantaged background, any student feels they are in an elite situation if they come to the university. Because only, I think, about 17 to 18% of students of the relevant age group actually reach universities in our country. And this is because, not because we don't have enough reservation, we don't have enough recognition that people have a problem in getting to higher education. But the fact that in less than 8 to 9% of SC, ST, minorities, women actually pass 12th class. You will not believe it, but 2 years ago, only 1,800 girls from the scheduled tribes sat for the CBSE exam. That is a shocking figure. And it is sometimes figures like these, when people say, oh, you know, there's no merit, is not being given a chance, reservation is being pushed forward. But please remember, 92% of scheduled caste and scheduled tribe children simply don't finish 12th class. So they're not even eligible for reservation. Now, it was with these ideas in mind that many of us who came at that time to JNU, I remember I was 24 when I came to JNU, I am now 70. And I'm still fighting for the freedom of education and the right of all children to have education. But when we came to the university and admissions were taking place, Sohail has already told you that was one of the first years of the proper admission for MAs and the integrated 5-year course, etc. So that the student body of the university was being enlarged at that time. And like all students' unions, I was a counselor from the School of Social Sciences. Like all student unions, we were very actively involved in assisting new students who were coming. Delhi was a strange place to come to. And also, the university was at the old campus. Down campus, as it used to be called later, but we used to call it the old campus. And there was a desire to help out the young people who were coming and who would be joining our university. And it was there that we met this young boy who actually started the movement for a new admission policy. He was a Gujar boy. He had got 50% in his graduate examination, in his BA. But Jawaharlal Nehru University had B+. 55% was the eligibility criteria. And so, whereas a boy from Doon School and St. Stephen's, or a girl from a convent school in Delhi and from LSR could easily be eligible for admission to Delhi University, this Gujar boy, who was the first in his tribe at that point to do his BA, was actually not even eligible to sit for the viva or to be called for interview. It is this which started the agitation. We decided to picket the center. I'm not going to name the center, but there was a center where this boy wanted admission. We decided to picket the center and stop the admissions. This is what the decision the union took. The decision was taken within a day and a half. Admissions were stopped on the 13th of July. And the university administration at that time, our vice chancellor was a very well-known diplomat, G. Parthasarathy. He was the founding vice chancellor of this university, and he immediately said that, you know, if the students have a problem with this, we should talk to them. And so talks began and negotiations began. We had a delegation from the union, and we had representatives of deans and teachers on the other side. And in fact, I remember that the first day of the negotiations, G. Parthasarathy himself was there to ask us to work as well as we, harmoniously as we could, all together, teachers and students and deans, and work out a solution to what he felt was a genuine problem. It is there that this whole discussion of points being given, weightages being given for the fact that you were born in a family or born in an area or educated in a region where you did not have the advantages that other children or other young people had. So that we would have a concept of excellence or achievement which would be more reflective of the real conditions in our society. And this was not for it, this was for you to be eligible to come for the interview. The weightage points were given for that. It was to get rid of that wretched B plus, which didn't tell you that B plus for a person who's had all the advantages in life and B plus for the first person in his tribe just did not count to the same thing. The achievement of the Gujar boy was way higher than B plus, but it was not being recognized. It was not being recognized because you had a system of excellence which only looked at points, which only looked at numbers and didn't look at the reality of a situation. And therefore, this argument began. We had to actually counter a concept of merit, which I hate to say, still is alive and kicking and very strong with us. Anyone who is upper caste, who is upper class, who is English speaking, who is male, who is not a tribal, has a far better chance of proving excellence than any of us who may have fought much harder. And I can tell you, as a woman of my age, I know you people are still fighting. Think what it was like for us when we didn't even have something like feminism to fall back on. We were simply regarded as zombies because we fought for our rights. So the idea that excellence is something which access to facilities and wealth and situation, this was an idea that we were concerned in our negotiations with the deans and the teachers. This was the idea that we wanted to crack. We said that excellence should be judged by the ability of a candidate or of a young person to deal with the circumstances in which they find themselves and then arrive at a level of achievement. So that we don't look at achievement as a figure which is already there. It's not a standard which is sitting there. It is a standard which is created by every student who fights, and it is a standard which is created by every student body that unites to fight. And that is what we decided to. The first phase of our negotiation fell through. The negotiation stopped. I think it was on the 19th or 20th of July of 1973, the negotiation stopped because everyone said that, no, we can't possibly have admissions on this basis. It would be impossible. You have to have a figure. You have to have a cutoff point. No, we just think like that. Because we're thinking of education as something from which we're keeping people out, not bringing people in. Whereas our union was concerned first and foremost with how we bring people in. Those who have been kept out, how do we keep bring them in? So even though the negotiations broke down, we appealed to the entire student body and appealed to all the students not to participate in any way in the admissions process until an agreement was arrived at. That agreement, I'm glad to say, was arrived at on the 24th of July. In other words, in a period of 10 days, the university actually had to come to an agreement because we did not allow admissions to take place anywhere. And I must say, this is something all of you must know also, this is something I learned very early on, that when we are united, we can fight. But when we break up, into groups and sections, etc., our goals may be the same, but we are not able to get our achievements because we get divided. So I think that is something which is very important to remember. Our differences we can always work out with each other. The point of on which we were agreed were two very major points which were written down in the letter that was finally sent to the Vice Chancellor and that was finally sent to all the schools. One was that student faculty committees of every center, except the school of, I think it was SIS, or no, it was languages. One of the schools had a central student faculty committee because their admissions used to be done centrally. The other schools, the centers used to conduct the admission. So we had, as Sohail told you, elected student representatives and representatives from the faculty. But we did have one other fact, which we insisted upon, which was that student members of the student faculty committee could be observers during the viva. We said we will not interfere with the process of the viva, we will not interfere with the grades that you give, but let us be observers. And that was significant, because I think just having students present there and having the whole process being transparent plays a very important role. A student is not penalized for having answered questions in Hindi or in not very good English. That doesn't matter. Similarly, being from a different background, not being familiar with a particular kind of approach and confidence that people have when they come from a particular class, those factors did not militate against the students. That was the first thing. The second thing was that all admissions had to be cleared by the student faculty committee before the recommendations could be sent forward to the offices for communication. So it was truly a collective effort. Admissions were a collective effort, and it was decided that the student faculty committees would determine how the policies and the cutoffs and how the cutoffs would be implemented and how the weightage points would be given, etc. All this was to be discussed within the student faculty committee. This was the second very important thing I learned, which was that the autonomy of a university has value only as long as the internal functioning of the university is democratic. Only then does autonomy have true value. Because if the students, teachers and the karamcharis, the people who make the university, if they are not part of the decision making and the implementation of the university, then autonomy only gives autonomy to the people sitting up there. And that is no good for any university, and it is no good definitely for the nation, which Jawaharlal Nehru said will be in, he said, if all is well with the universities, all will be well with the nation. It's written there under his statue. And I think all is well with the universities only when students, teachers and karamcharis function in a democratic environment and in a transparent environment, with the idea of opening the doors of the university and the gates of the university to all students, and not with this idea that we will keep out people so that we can retain our elite character. I want to thank you so much for your patient hearing. I am happy to be part of your movement, and I'm really grateful to you for carrying on the struggle that we began 40 years ago. And I do believe that we took the right decisions then, because all of you are here today. Thank you so much.
So we can now take a couple of questions from the audience.
Oh. बाकी बहस से तो हम लोग वाकिफ हैं, लेकिन ये जो स्टूडेंट फैकल्टी का जो 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 मैडम ने भी बताया ये था, तो ये खत्म कैसे हो गया और ये अभी क्यों नहीं है, और अगर है तो इसकी क्या गुंजाइश है स्टूडेंट्स का बतौर रिप्रेजेंटेटिव? अभी मतलब आपकी आपकी बातचीत में शायद क्लियर नहीं हुआ था, आई गेट टू नो फ्रॉम हर, इट्स जस्ट दैट दे आर देयर एज एन ऑब्जर्वर ओनली। सो एक ये, और जो दूसरा सवाल है जो कैंपस में तकरीबन उठता रहा और थोड़ा कम ही उसको मौका मिला उठने का, मुस्लिम डिप्रेशन पॉइंट या माइनॉरिटी डिप्रेशन पॉइंट, ये भी एक बहस है, और क्या इस ये इसमें क्या हो सकता है, क्योंकि अगर हम डिप्रेशन पॉइंट को पूरा देख रहे हैं, ये इसमें आया था कि ज्यादातर जेएनयू के अंदर मुस्लिम स्टूडेंट हैं वो खास तीन सेंटर से ही हैं और ट्रिपल एस में और बाकी जगहों पे कम है, वो कैसे लागू होने की क्या गुंजाइश है कैंपस के अंदर, क्योंकि जो भी कोशिशें एडमिनिस्ट्रेशन की तरफ से हुई उसमें कोई ठोस बात कभी निकलते हुए किसी कमेटी ने कोई ठोस बात बोली नहीं, बट क्योंकि आप इतना तफसील से रख रहे हैं, सो इफ यू कैन पुट सम लाइट ऑन दैट, दैट वुड बी ग्रेट।
पॉलिसी की मैं बात कर रही हूँ वो 73 टू 83 थी, उसके बाद 83 में चेंज की गई।
देखिए एक तो वो जो वाइव गुस्से का जो प्रॉब्लम है उसकी मैं आपको एक एग्जांपल देता हूँ। एक मैं स्टेट का नाम नहीं लूंगा, लेकिन एक हिंदी स्पीकिंग स्टेट से एक स्टूडेंट आया था ग्रेजुएशन करके, हिंदी मीडियम में उसने एक सब्जेक्ट पढ़ा था और वो अपने स्टेट का टॉपर था, और जेएनयू में उसने उसी सब्जेक्ट में एमए में अप्लाई किया और रिटर्न में और वाइवा दोनों में वो फेल हो गया। तो फिर काफी हम लोगों ने हंगामा किया और पता है चला कि उससे एक तो क्वेश्चन पेपर अंग्रेजी में था और उसके बाद जब वाइवा हुआ तो वो भी अंग्रेजी में हुआ। तो हमने ये कहा कि इस बच्चे इस स्टूडेंट ने जो कुछ पढ़ा है उसकी नॉलेज का एग्जामिनेशन नहीं हो रहा था, वो अंग्रेजी कितनी जानता है वो टेस्ट हो रहा था, तो इसका वाइवा दोबारा होना चाहिए। तो फिर उस सब्जेक्ट को जानने वाले वो फैकल्टी मेंबर्स जो हिंदी में अपने कॉलेज डेज में उन्होंने उस सब्जेक्ट को हिंदी में पढ़ा था उनका एक और सिलेक्शन कमेटी बनी, उसमें उसका दोबारा वाइवा हुआ और वो पास हो गया, उसने इस यूनिवर्सिटी से एमए किया, उसके बाद उसने इसी यूनिवर्सिटी से एमफिल और पीएचडी की, और उसके बाद फिर वो एक और राज्य में बहुत साल पढ़ाता रहा और लौट के जेएनयू में आ गया, अभी जेएनयू में पढ़ाता है। तो ये संभव हो पाया था स्टूडेंट फैकल्टी कमेटीज की वजह से। जब हम एज ऑब्जर्वर भी बैठते थे तो हमको ये अंदाजा हो जाता था कि ये जो इंटरव्यू हो रहा है इसमें तो ये बच्चा इसका चांस है नहीं, क्योंकि जिस तरीके सवाल पूछे जा रहे हैं अगर और वाइवा में अगर, और ये हम सब जानते हैं हमारे मुल्क की जो रियलिटी है कि उसमें कास्टिस बायसेस हैं, बहुत ज्यादा कास्टिस बायसेस हैं, तो हमारी रोजमर्रा की जबान में जो मुहावरे उससे आपको पता चल जाता है कि कितने कास्टिस बायसेस हैं। तो अगर हम बहुत ज्यादा मोहतात नहीं है, बहुत ज्यादा केयर नहीं करते तो ये होने की गुंजाइश है, और स्टूडेंट फैकल्टी कमेटीज 84 में खत्म हो गई, उसकी एक बैकग्राउंड है लंबी, मैं उस बहस में नहीं जाना चाहता, लेकिन 83 का एक एजिटेशन हुआ था और उसके बाद से ये सारा का सारा मामला बैठ गया। उसमें स्टूडेंट मूवमेंट की भी अपनी कुछ कमजोरियां रही थी जिसने मौका दिया, क्योंकि जो पहला हमला एडमिशन पॉलिसी पर आया था वो इमरजेंसी के फौरन बाद आया, इमरजेंसी उसके बाद अमेंडमेंट्स होने शुरू हुए, इमरजेंसी में हुए उसके बाद हुए, फिर उसको कुछ रिस्टोर किया गया, फिर 83 का एजिटेशन हुआ और उसके बाद ये अटैक हुआ। तो स्टूडेंट फैकल्टी कमेटी उसके बाद से फंक्शन नहीं कर रही और उनको दोबारा कायम किया जाए उसके लिए एक लंबे स्ट्रगल की तैयारी की उस सबकी जरूरत है, क्योंकि उसके बिना ये हमेशा मुमकिन रहेगा कि आप लोगों को बाहर रख सके। जहां तक जो दूसरा सवाल आपने उठाया है वो बड़ा कॉम्प्लेक्स सा मामला है कि क्या मुसलमानों के लिए रिजर्वेशन होना चाहिए
और माइनॉरिटीज
या माइनॉरिटीज का रिजर्वेशन होना चाहिए, वो एक बहुत कॉम्प्लेक्स मामला है, क्योंकि माइनॉरिटीज वो
सारी की सारी माइनॉरिटीज या कोई एक रिलीजियस माइनॉरिटी को आप ले लें, वो एक मोनोलिथिक ब्लॉक नहीं है। मुस्लिम माइनॉरिटी को ले लीजिए, मुस्लिम माइनॉरिटी में बहुत ज्यादा पिछड़े हुए लोग हैं। मुस्लिम माइनॉरिटी मुस्लिम्स के अंदर भी कास्टिज्म है और ठीक ठाक ऑपरेट करता है, तो उसको प्रॉपरली समझे बगैर ये पूरा का पूरा के किस लेवल पे हो सकता है, किस लेवल पे होना चाहिए, क्या उसका प्रोसीजर होगा, कैसे होगा, उसके लिए बहुत लंबी हमको खुद अपने आप समझने की जरूरत है। लेकिन ये जरूर है कि जो मुसलमानों में पिछड़ा तबका है उनको ये किसी लेवल के ऊपर ये कंपनसेटरी उनका होना जरूरी है, या मुसलमान लड़कियों को जो तालीम से रोका जा रहा है, और जो इस्लाम के नाम पे और जो बहुत कुछ हमारे यहाँ झंडे उठाए जा रहे हैं, तो वो एक बहुत ही कॉम्प्लेक्स प्रॉब्लम है। लेकिन उसके ऊपर एक लंबी तैयारी और हमको खुद अपनी एक समझ इवॉल्व करने की जरूरत है, इससे पहले कि वो उसको कॉन्क्रेटाइज करने की शक्ल में हम लोग करें।
Points were actually given, you know, when you look at gender or SC, because I was discussing this similar thing in a different context. So how do you really quantify at one level how much is a deprivation, more or less?
मुझे लगता है कि ये क्वांटिफिकेशन का जो प्रॉब्लम है ये सिर्फ डेप्रिवेशन या बैकवर्डनेस के पॉइंट्स की बात नहीं है। ये क्वांटिफिकेशन का प्रॉब्लम एक जनरल प्रॉब्लम है जो कि खास तौर से हायर एजुकेशन में आई थिंक और जनरली एजुकेशन में ही इसका बड़ा रोल है इसके, क्योंकि बात ये है कि आप एक क्वालिटेटिव फीचर्स को आप क्वांटिफाई करने की कोशिश कर रहे हैं, और इसलिए मुझे लगता है कि इसकी जो सल्यूशन है हम लोग फाइनर एंड फाइनर मेजरमेंट के तौर तरीके तो हम लोग कोशिश कर सकते हैं ढूंढने के, और मुझे लगता है सारा टाइम ये किया जा रहा है। अगर आप देखिए अभी जो न्यू एजुकेशन पॉलिसी का जो ड्राफ्ट डॉक्यूमेंट आया है उसमें तो वो सिर्फ हर चीज़ को क्वांटिफाई करने की बात सोच रहे हैं, आपकी स्किल क्वांटिफाई करने की, आपकी एजुकेशन क्वांटिफाई करने की, आपकी हैसियत क्वांटिफाई करने की, हर चीज़ को क्वांटिफाई किया जा रहा है। लेकिन असली इशू क्वालिटी की है कि आप किसी भी चीज़ की क्वालिटी को किस तरह से मेजर करेंगे, और मुझे लगता है कि इसमें जो क्वांटिफिकेशन का प्रॉब्लम जो आता है वो यूं ही आता है क्योंकि हमारे पास क्वालिटी ज़्यादा है या लोग ज़्यादा हैं और हमारे पास फैसिलिटी कम है, तभी हम सोचते हैं कि हम इसकी क्वालिटी को क्वांटिफाई करके किसी तरह से इसको बीच में से निकाल लें या इसको बाहर रखें। सो आई थिंक ये जो स्ट्रगल है कि एजुकेशन हर बच्चे का हक होना चाहिए, और एजुकेशन जो है वो हर बच्चे का हक उस स्तर तक होना चाहिए जिस स्तर तक वो बच्चा जाना चाहे, जिसके लिए एजुकेशन को मुफ्त होना पड़ेगा। क्योंकि हम ये नहीं कह सकते हैं, जैसे हमारे ड्राफ्ट डॉक्यूमेंट्स न्यू एजुकेशन पॉलिसी के कहते हैं कि हम चॉइस पे डिटरमिन करेंगे और अचीवमेंट पे डिटरमिन करेंगे कि कौन आगे पढ़ेगा और कौन स्किल डेवलपमेंट सेंटर में जाएगा, किसी का चॉइस नहीं होता। ये चॉइस नहीं है कि आपके माँ बाप के पास पैसे नहीं हैं और आपको अपने माँ बाप को मदद करनी है या आपको जल्दी नौकरी लेनी है या जल्दी पैसे कमाने हैं, ये चॉइस नहीं होती। तो इसलिए हमें ये जो इसका इसको खोलना बहुत ज़रूरी है, नहीं तो हर वक्त कोई ना कोई क्वांटिफिकेशन में तो यही होता है, कोई ना कोई तो कट ऑफ पॉइंट पे आएगा और जो कट ऑफ पॉइंट के नीचे आएगा उसको लगेगा कि देखो मैं सिर्फ इतनी सी चीज़ की वजह से रह गया, और जो निकल गया ऊपर उसको लगेगा अरे मैं तो बच गया। सो ये जो आइडिया है ये नहीं होना चाहिए, होना ये चाहिए कि हर एक को अपॉर्चुनिटी मिलनी चाहिए। और हम जब अपने यूनिवर्सिटीज़ में या अपने स्कूल्स में या अपने स्टूडेंट ऑर्गेनाइजेशंस में या अपनी आइडेंटिटी ऑर्गेनाइजेशंस में, चाहे हमारे दलित ऑर्गेनाइजेशंस हो, चाहे लेफ्ट ऑर्गेनाइजेशंस हो, चाहे अलग अलग ऑर्गेनाइजेशंस हो, हम अपनी ऑर्गेनाइजेशंस में अपनी लड़ाई आगे ले जाते हुए भी, अपने डे टू डे प्रॉब्लम्स को ले जाते हुए भी, ये चीज़ हर वक्त अपने जहन में रखनी चाहिए कि हर बच्चे को हक मिलना चाहिए जो इस वक्त उसको नहीं मिले। स्टूडेंट फैकल्टी कमेटी की कॉम्पोजिशन जो है वो एक पूरे सेंटर के स्टूडेंट्स, और अगर वो इलेक्टेड रिप्रेजेंटेटिव्स होंगे तो उनका डेफिनेटली ज़्यादा रोल होगा वो स्टूडेंट्स के प्रॉब्लम्स को उठाने में, और एक स्टूडेंट फैकल्टी के जो स्टूडेंट मेंबर्स हैं उनको ज़्यादा हिम्मत और उनको ज़्यादा स्ट्रेंथ भी मिलती है अगर उनको पता है कि वो इलेक्टेड मेंबर्स हैं। दूसरी बात ये है कि स्टूडेंट फैकल्टी कमिटीज़ में उनके फंक्शन क्या हों, आप स्टूडेंट फैकल्टी कमेटी के मेजर फंक्शंस, वेदर दे आर प्रॉक्टोरियल, वेदर दे आर एकेडमिक, वेदर दे आर रिलेटेड टू एडमिशन, उन फंक्शंस को आप श्रिंक करते जाओगे तो स्टूडेंट फैकल्टी कमेटी फिर एक ऐसी एक सिर्फ एक कमेटी रह जाती है जिसकी कोई ज़्यादा रोल नहीं रहता। आइडिया ये होना चाहिए, और मुझे ये नहीं पता इस वक्त आप लोग स्टूडेंट फैकल्टी कमेटी जे एन यू में अभी फंक्शन करती है तो क्या काम करती है स्टूडेंट फैकल्टी कमेटी, उसके उसके दायरे में क्या क्या सवाल आते हैं, इज इट कोई इम्पोर्टेंट चीज़ें भी आपके दायरे में आते हैं या आप सिर्फ मिलजुल के, आई एम नॉट फेमिलियर विद दैट, ये तो आप लोग ज़्यादा बता सकते हैं, पर ये बहुत ज़रूरी है कि जो मेजर फंक्शन सेंटर के हैं वो फंक्शंस उसके दायरे में होने चाहिए। ये नहीं हो सकता कि एक स्टूडेंट फैकल्टी कमेटी है पर वो स्टूडेंट फैकल्टी कमेटी एडमिशंस पे कमेंट नहीं कर सकता, एडमिशन पॉलिसी पे कोई उसका इन्वॉल्वमेंट नहीं है। वो स्टूडेंट फैकल्टी कमेटी हैज टू बी द कमेटी विच रन्स द सेंटर एंड देयरफॉर ऑल एस्पेक्ट्स ऑफ द सेंटर, whether it's a question of the caste composition, when there is a question of particular section and action being taken against particular students, on whether it's that, whether it's admissions, whether it's grading, we know that grading may be bahut kuch hota hai, bahut problems hote hain, all these issues should come under the student faculty committee, it should be within the range of the student faculty committee.